strength. Your name is power, a strong tower makes me safe. Oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name. Strong tower makes me safe.
Good morning. It's January 24th, 2021. Lesson 8 in our Winter Quarterly. The subject of the lesson today is called as the intercessor. Lesson scripture and the focus scriptures in John chapter 17, verses 14 through 24. Called as the intercessor. Jesus is called as the intercessor. This is another calling that we've deemed of him, the called as the intercessor. And what we have here in these 11 verses, verses 14 through 24, what we have here, what is going on here, is Jesus is praying for his disciples and he's praying for all people, for those to come. He's praying for the disciples. This is one of the last documented prayers that Jesus prayed, and he's in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he's praying, and he's interceding. Now, remember, Jesus knew his fate long before the crucifixion. Jesus knew what was going to happen. Jesus knew he would be betrayed. Jesus knew that he had to die in order to save us, not just them, us from sin. He knew that, and he knew the time was upon him for him to be given over, for the beating that he was about to take, for the death that he was about to face. But in that time when he's praying for the disciples first. And he's praying for them because of the fact that he knows if they're going to kill me, what I'm implanting in these men, they're going to keep doing. And then if they keep doing that, those that killed me are going to want to kill them. So he's praying for his disciples' strength. He's praying for God to protect his disciples because he knows that they're going to continue and they're going to be bounties on their head. He says in the scripture that He's praying for them, and he's praying for, because he is not of this world. Jesus did not belong to this. We do not belong to this. His disciples did not belong to this world. And so if we don't belong to this world and we're operating in the word, the world is going to have a problem with that. So Jesus was praying on behalf of his disciples that they may be able to face, that they may have protection, that God may continue to protect them when he's gone, because they were not of this world. They are of the word. We are of the word. You ever in the darkness and your eyes have adjusted to the darkness and it's maybe just a little faint moonlight coming in your, or light from the outside coming into your window, and you've adjusted to that. You've adjusted to being into the darkness. So often people, their lives get adjusted to the darkness and realize this, the world is darkness. The world is darkness. Now I said that to say this. Now when you're in your room, when you're in your house and it's dark, when somebody pops the light on, or somebody shines a flashlight, if any type of light comes on, it startles you. And you have to close your eyes before you can adjust to it. It always to the point where it hurts your eyes to see that light. That's the same way the world feels when the world's lights are shining. See, when our lights are shining, the world, that darkness has a problem with that. That darkness wants to be dark again. It wants to turn off our lights by any means necessary. So Jesus was praying for that protection, that our lights may continue to shine. Jesus not only prayed for his disciples, he prayed also that those that will believe in me in the future, that you may protect them from persecution. He's talking about us. He's talking about our kids that were to come. He's talking about our foreparents that came before us. Anybody that will believe in him, Jesus was praying for them. He's praying for their protection. Because understand and realize this, the world is still a cruel place. The enemy hasn't stopped. The devil is busy. He continues to work. He continues to work. And Jesus knew that. That's why he prayed that prayer. And remember, understand, Jesus is getting ready to die. He's getting ready to face his death. He's getting ready to face his death. Okay? He's getting ready to... But he's praying for us. He's praying for the disciples. And he's praying for us. Those of us that are here now, that hear my voice. He's praying for us. Getting ready to face death. Yet he's still interceding. He's still interceding on our behalf at the brink of death. Now think of this. If you know that you're dying, you know that you're dying, how many of you are still interceding on your brothers and sisters in Christ? How many of you are doing that when you know death is upon you? So many people are probably won't be praying that prayer that Jesus is praying because they're still trying to fix things. See, if we work daily in our life, if we work daily in our lives to be Christ-like, to follow God's word, to stay under God's umbrella of protection, when the day, the minute, the hour, the second comes when death is upon us, we can pray that prayer that Jesus prayed. Why can we pray that prayer? Because we know that we're good. If you know that you're good, if you've been doing what God told you to do, if you know you're good, you can pray that prayer of intercession for somebody else when you know that it is your time. Now, granted, I'm not saying that when it comes your time, you shouldn't be getting your last, getting the last forgiveness out. That may just be a knee-jerk reaction. But what I'm saying is what Jesus was able to do this because Jesus had lived a just life. He knew that there was no flaw in him. He knew that there couldn't be any flaw in him because of the people that will come after him, the followers that will come after him, us. There couldn't be any flaw in him because even in anything, look at the world now. When there are elections, when people are running for any type of office, there's always something against one candidate or another. That they bring their past up. They do this. They say this. And it divides people. But Jesus, by him living a just life, what do you have to say against him? He knew that he had to stay on God's path of righteousness. And even unto getting ready to die, he still cares about us. He still loves us so much that he was willing to get down and pray to God to continue to protect us. Those that will come after me, those that will believe in me, protect them, God. Because they are not of this world. We're of the word. We're of the word, my brothers and sisters. So we don't jail with the word, with the world. We don't jail with that. They can't coexist together. We're light, that's darkness. Light shines. Darkness clouds, darkness covers. How many of you love gloomy days where the sun never comes out? How many of you just really love those type of days constantly? Even when it's cold, you still like to see a little sunshine out. When the storms came and ravaged the Gulf Coast, all the hurricanes that came this year throughout the world, excuse me, and throughout the country, here on the Gulf Coast when we were battered with the storms. It was refreshing to see the sunlight come out. It was refreshing to see the rain gone. It was refreshing to see the darkness subside. It was refreshing to see the clouds diminish. When the sunlight came, it gave us, it was the fact that the storm was over. It said, it has passed. It is time for us to rebuild. When the light comes into your life, when you've been in a world of darkness, yes, it hurts. Yes, it cringes your eyes sometimes. It's the signification that it's time to put things together, put things back together, or put things together if they were always broken. It's time to finish some things that you started and you got sidetracked from. That's what the light does. And Jesus knew that we would be constant builders. He knew that we would be constant repairers. He knew that we would be constant lights in darkness. And that the enemy would constantly try to blow out our candles. But I come to tell you today, my brothers and sisters, we are eternal flames. Our lights shall always shine. No matter when the enemy tries to suck the oxygen out of our fire, we will still shine. Why will we still shine? Because in the midst of this, when this happened, when they crucified Jesus, he didn't stay there. He didn't stay in that grave. That body got up. And when he got up, when that body sat up in the grave and he opened his eyes, he rose. He arose with all power. So if we're joint heirs, if we're joint heirs with Jesus Christ, when we call on him, our lights, they never go out. The smallest flame, the smallest spark can light up a room. It could start a fire that could warm the coldest, the smallest spark. That's all we need is just a small spark and call on the name of Jesus, because he has all power, even facing death. He was caring about you. He was caring about me. Let that simmer in your spirit as you go throughout this day, and have a blessed one. Hallelujah and amen.